HiBridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Better Humans, What the Mental Health Pandemic Teaches Us About Humanity by Janeane Bernstein, EdD. Read by Janeane Bernstein, EdD. Foreword. Dear Better Humans, I hope this finds you well. Ring, ring. It's 2018. And I'm sitting in my office near the UCLA campus in Westwood, California. The phone rings. Yes, an actual landline phone. My reaction is to quickly answer the call, and yet I hesitate. My body tenses with a twinge of anxiety because of the uncertainty of what waits for me on the other end of the phone. It rings again. I take a deep breath, close my eyes, and prepare to provide support. Hello, NAMI Westside Los Angeles. This is Erin. How can I help you? For those of you who know NAMI, you know. And for those of you who don't, NAMI is the National Alliance on Mental Illness, which is the nation's largest grassroots organization dedicated to improving the lives of those affected by mental health conditions. So essentially, we are dedicated to helping everyone, as is the message in this amazing book. Context. 1 in 5 U.S. adults and 1 in 6 U.S. youth aged 6 to 17 experience a mental health disorder each year. Suicide is the second leading cause of death among people aged 10 to 14. Millions of people in the U.S. are affected by mental health conditions each year. That means you or someone you know and love is affected. It's important to measure how common mental health conditions are so we can understand their physical, social, and financial impact, and so we can show that no one is alone. These numbers are also powerful tools for raising public awareness, stigma busting, and advocating for better health care. Many people don't know about the importance of mental health until they are in crisis and need answers. As the executive director of NAMI Westside Los Angeles County, I have answered the phone many times to hear a sobbing mother, sister, husband, or friend on the other line reaching out for urgent help, feeling like there is nowhere to turn and they are all alone on this journey. Feeling alone. That all started to change in 2020, when humanity experienced a collective trauma. Ring, ring, it's COVID-19, a global pandemic calling. Well, no one was prepared to answer that call. But in some capacity, we all had to deal with the unfathomable number of deaths, pervasive sense of fear, economic instability, and forced physical distancing from loved ones, friends, and our individual communities. This collective trauma exacerbated unprecedented stresses, and, if there could be a silver lining, it also shed a new light on the importance of our collective mental health. The shame and stigma associated with mental health was put on hold, and then put on speakerphone. The human race was experiencing feelings of isolation, anxiety, depression, and uncertainty from the pandemic, and we were in it together. A call to action. On December 7, 2021, a 53-page advisory from the U.S. Surgeon General, Vivek H. Murthy, focused the nation's attention on the youth mental health crisis. He states, "Our obligation to act is not just medical, it's moral. I believe that. Coming out of the COVID-19 pandemic, we have an unprecedented opportunity as a country to rebuild in a way that refocuses our identity and common values, puts people first, and strengthens our connections to each other. We have an opportunity to be better humans." My colleague and fellow heart leader, Janeane Bernstein, is answering the Surgeon General's call to action with her amazing work in the mental health space. And most recently, with her new book, Better Humans, and you are one of them. Kudos to you for listening to this book. You are a traveler on the life path of learning and growth. Prepare to be inspired by the heartfelt, authentic stories of the previously untold silent battles with mental health and the voices of youth, our future leaders in this space. Get ready to be informed by what created and fueled the mental health pandemic, and learn from the stories and insights of teachers, educators, and mental health professionals, often the ones on the front lines of this pandemic. You will have the opportunity to think outside the box, hear from people of ages and backgrounds, and walk away with real-time resources. I first met Janeane as a guest on her podcast. She is a wonderful listener and storyteller and creates a safe space for truth to shine. She shares pure vulnerability and golden nuggets of wisdom throughout the book. Janeane's varied background in education, media, technology, teaching, communications, and journalism create an all-encompassing eclectic lens for the listener to gain perspective with tangible tools and candid conversations. Listening to this book feels like you're having a cup of coffee with some of your dearest friends, reflecting on what happened and discussing, how can we be better? How can we do better for ourselves and others? These are big questions, and you are a better human for asking them. So happy to have shared a few words with you and have you join Janeane on her journey in finding solutions. Be well, better humans. With gratitude, Erin Raftery Ryan, Executive Director, NAMI Westside, Los Angeles. Introduction. Everyone you meet is fighting a battle you know nothing about. Be kind, always. Robin Williams. I wanted to write Better Humans to share with you, my fellow humans, how we need to be better and do better as a collective whole. This book is for students, teachers, parents, school administrators, businesses, policymakers, and anyone else, really, as I provide a glimpse into what you should know about the mental health pandemic, how we got here, and its impact. I have included numerous conversations with people of all ages who share lessons learned and insights into how you and I can be better to ourselves, our loved ones, colleagues, and total strangers. We need to do better as humans with the choices we make, how we take care of one another, and how we connect and communicate. We need to embrace diversity and inclusivity and prioritize and treat mental health and well-being. We must examine each and every context and every possible demographic impacted by the lack of mental health services due to inequities, disparities, and inclusivity. We are a hurting nation where students and adults' mental health needs are unmet. The wait time or access to mental health professionals is worrisome. And if you do manage to get an appointment, there is not enough time and resources to address the magnitude of needs. Without help, mental health issues impact every aspect of your life, causing a ripple effect of issues. Solutions and strategies are not happening soon enough, and the lack of attention and prioritization given to mental health became even more apparent from 2020 on. Now, you and I have an opportunity to create a world that can positively impact the minds and actions of students of all ages, adults in every work setting and age group. This is the time to end mental health stigma in all contexts and change the trajectory of people's lives. COVID-19 was a wake-up call for humanity and a test to our own resilience. I don't know very many people who haven't experienced some form of loss since March 2020. This loss might have been losing a friend or relative to COVID-19 or another illness, either suddenly or long-term. Losing yourself was a common theme as well, as more and more people sought psychological counseling for a new or past trauma, addiction, or mental health issue, while marginalized groups never had the support and resources to begin with. And the demand for mental health professionals outweighed availability and access. Beginning in March 2020, you might have also lost your interpersonal connections, your job, your sense of self-worth, and felt disconnected from the very people under your roof as you tried to process the news of the world. You were consumed with stress and anxiety as you tried to get through the long days. Days blended into weeks, months, and now years on Zoom. Your life consisted of multitasking as a mother, for example, trying to work from home, homeschool kids, pay bills, put food on the table, and maintain your sanity, all while grieving the loss of a loved one or several. No one would have anticipated how 2020 would devastate millions of lives within the United States and throughout the world. One day, we were in crowded airports, traveling the world, visiting amusement parks, attending concerts, cheering our favorite teams in packed stadiums, having dinner with friends and colleagues, running through Grand Central Station in rush hour, visiting museums, going to the movies, partying on college campuses, and connecting physically and emotionally, shaking hands, hugging, kissing, chatting with strangers. And the next, life as we knew it, was shattered. We could not have fathomed that a virus that originated in Wuhan, China, would devastate our world like a science fiction movie most of us would never want to see. In February 2020, I remember sitting in the aisle seat of an airplane next to a woman in the middle seat who looked weak and feverish. She barely moved the entire flight, except for her head that flopped back and forth as she slept. I thought she might have bronchitis or the flu. For some reason, I had a surgical mask in my purse, and I thought, I don't want to catch bronchitis, my kryptonite, so I quickly put my mask on. When we landed, the woman to the right of her looked stressed and said to me, "She is so incredibly sick." That was so smart you wore a mask. Little did I know, my seatmate might have had COVID-19, which was not even part of my vocabulary then. Flash forward, and millions of people lost their lives to COVID-19, experienced massive job losses, went through the mental and emotional effects of social isolation, witnessed and/or participated in protests, viewed senseless and horrific deaths from police brutalities, discrimination of all kinds, devastating school shootings, and other unimaginable incidents of gun violence, massive disruption of supply chains, soaring rates of domestic violence, abuse, racial and ethnic inequities, homelessness, anxiety, depression, suicide, divorce, drug and alcohol abuse, consequences from isolation, struggles of working from home, including juggling work-life balance, food insecurity, and so on. No one was immune to the ripple effects of the pandemic. I did have a conversation or two in 2020 with people who were living in their own little bubbles, not in touch with the reality and suffering of those affected by COVID-19. It pained me to listen to their insignificant, minuscule struggles. All I had to do was view the numerous emotional Instagram posts in 2020 from crying, exhausted, and terrified nurses who were brand new to their field. And I felt their pain reverberate through me. And then there were students, teachers, counselors, therapists, doctors, frontline workers, and more who openly shared an inside look at their daily emotional pandemic struggles that most of us would never go through. Millions of people lost jobs, looked for work that seemed impossible, or worked remotely in a whole new world of chaos. For those living in retirement homes, COVID-19 forced them into social distancing and isolation from loved ones to keep them safe. But the social isolation became detrimental to their mental, emotional, and physical health. Mothers and caregivers tried to manage all aspects of their lives under one roof: work, childcare, homeschooling, remote learning, motherhood, and other relationships all melded together like a weird new flavor of ice cream that no one had ever heard of, or wanted for that matter. There was no prep time to learn how to function remotely in social isolation. Schools had to shift rapidly to online instruction, and pandemic life replaced what was normal and familiar. Thus began a life of mental, physical, and emotional trauma that was adorned by masks of all types and a constant dose of hand sanitizer, social distancing, isolation, fear, and anxiety. You might have been one of the millions of students having to live at home, no longer able to experience college life and the freedom of personal growth. You heard plenty of stories about how great college life was going to be, but yours was an experience confined to your bedroom, staring at a computer screen. So, you chose to shut your computer cameras off during classes and became a faceless black screen with a name. Maybe you were paying attention or doing something else like sleeping, eating, watching TikTok videos, or scrolling on your phone to just numb out your pandemic pain. You had to shut yourselves out from the world to the detriment of your mental, physical, and emotional health. And the plethora of suffering is not surprising. As I set out to structure this book, there seemed to be more and more articles published about prioritizing mental health in schools and businesses. But what does this really mean? And when will there be a mental health care system that provides equal access, resources, and enough skilled professionals that offer training and education for diverse and difficult needs of people of all ages and backgrounds? With a shortage of trained therapists and counselors, you might have finally decided to reach out for help, only to find out you can't find anyone available, or your insurance doesn't cover therapy. If you reached out to your counseling center at your school, the wait times were long and the resources limited. This was disheartening because how were you supposed to get the help you needed? There must be consistent messaging about mental health, training, and education, and an elimination of stigma. Mental health professionals must also be compensated properly for the essential work they do and the long, stressful days they face treating a wide variety of mental health issues and illnesses. The pandemic raised awareness around empathy, acceptance, a dismantling of mindsets, and the creation of policies and priorities that put mental health at the forefront. These are societal changes that will impact the trajectory of future generations. We can't afford to look away at the structural problems in the mental health care system. The exodus of essential workers and the lack of initiatives to meet the needs of children and adults. We needed mental health action a long time ago, but it took a pandemic to prove it. The media shines a light almost daily on how there are initiatives to reduce the stigma associated with mental health, and celebrities are speaking out as well. However, these conversations must be embedded in consistent messaging and agendas in our educational institutions, healthcare systems, and in the minds and actions of parents and other individuals throughout society, so we are all on the same page, reinforcing the same messages. Mental health initiatives must take precedent. You can be an incredible student academically, But if you are struggling with mental health issues and a drug addiction, you will face an uphill battle throughout your lifetime. Mental health stigma and acceptance of the status quo is embedded in our culture. However, 2022 is a wake-up call to stop numbing out and do away with mindsets that are outdated and do not serve us. Our world is suffering. People of all ages, socioeconomic backgrounds, gender and racial identities, and professions are hurting, and the data proves it. The question is, what can be done, and how soon? We have lost touch with what really matters: human connection, thoughtfulness, empathy, compassion, intergenerational experiences, consistent and inclusive mental health initiatives that reach diverse and marginalized communities, and meaningful experiences that lift us up and bring people together instead of further dividing us. Many of us are numb to the constant chaos and horrific news of more school shootings. As of October 5th, 2022, Education Week magazine reported that there have been 35 school shootings in the U.S., resulting in deaths or injuries. These incidents are often caused by young men in their late teens and 20s. Where did the origins of all this hate come from? Why would anyone decide to purchase assault rifles, boast about them on social media, and shoot up a school, killing teachers, staff, and innocent children shortly after killing their grandmother? The U.S. has a serious gun problem, but at the root is also a mental health issue, where research is needed to study the backgrounds of the people who plan such horrific acts of violence. Their social media accounts need to be analyzed, and social media companies must be held accountable by reviewing accounts 24/7. They need to set standards for what is acceptable and not acceptable content, and take action on red flag warnings. Right now, it feels like the Wild West, and anything goes on social media, including sex trafficking, child porn, abuse, and hate crimes. I believe some incidents of gun violence reflect a life lived in a cycle of abuse and suffering that perpetuated from childhood through adulthood. Oftentimes, these individuals suffer from mental illness, social rejection, depression, and abuse as children. With support from school administrators, teachers, and staff, should tune in to the students who don't seem to fit in, such as social outcasts or anyone else who seems troubled, and implement ongoing mental health and wellness check-ins with students. This can be done on an app every morning, like you would when you seek mental health counseling. With well-thought-out strategies for early detection in schools and work settings, only then will we begin to see a reduction in hate crimes, and people can get the care they need. People suffer in silence, and no one knows until it is too late. Why didn't anyone notice the self-inflicted marks on the Uvalde, Texas shooter's face and do anything before he flipped a switch and destroyed lives May 2022? In an interview with ABC News, students said they were frightened of him. He boasted about the cut marks he did himself. Wasn't this enough of a red flag to do something? Who should have followed through? And what could have been done? This is now an all too common occurrence. Students are frightened to go to school, a place where they are not supposed to be having shooter drills, and worried about whether their school is next. Schools are a place to interact, grow socially and emotionally, and feel safe and connected. Is it any surprise that students are experiencing so much trauma, anxiety, depression, and so many suicidal thoughts? The weight of the world is too much, And after having been forced to study remotely, many don't feel connected when they are finally back in person. We have lost our ability to connect, to feel connected, to feel heard and understood. Many don't feel listened to, and they might not have someone that they can vent to, so they keep everything inside. They escape to their inner worlds and numb out. School staff and teachers are pushed to their limit. They not only shifted to online learning, but dealt with ongoing debates on everything from mask policies to what should be taught in the curriculum. For example, critical race theory, while being poorly compensated and disrespected. Hundreds of thousands of teachers have left their profession. School mental health professionals and staff have not been properly trained and equipped to handle the growing demands of the pandemic. They left too. However, when you hear from some of the young adults interviewed for this book, sometimes all someone wanted was someone to listen to, whatever it is they were going through, and for that listener to then share their own story of personal struggles, all without passing judgment. They just wanted to know there was someone available to connect with and to feel heard. How are you? No, really. How are you? Truthfully, you might not be okay. Millions of people of all ages are filled with anxiety, depression, suicidal thoughts, PTSD, and more. We are numbing out on TikTok, Instagram, and other platforms. There is a spike in substance abuse for numerous reasons, ranging from depression and anxiety to someone's life completely imploding and not feeling seen and heard. There are also long-term effects of COVID-19. Many people have had COVID-19 on more than one occasion. And long-term side effects can zap you of your energy, mentally deplete you, and spiral you into despair. Sadly, people share on social media their raw emotions, pain, and suffering, and how their life has been put on hold because of the long-term effects of this deadly virus, which was once not even part of our vocabulary back in early 2020. People have spent an enormous amount of time socially isolated, making being back in person awkward and uncomfortable. We have forgotten how to communicate. We are tethered to our electronic devices, which provide comfort and a lifeline to other places to retreat to mentally and emotionally. Another downside to our tech addiction is that we see things we will never be able to unsee. Images and news are available 24/7 that are often graphic and amped up to feed the media machine, getting people to click and view on images not meant for consumption. No wonder we are up at night scrolling, swiping, looking for something that will make us feel whole, but at the same time, feeling hopeless, disengaged, and filled with feelings of inadequacy and unfulfillment, unable to feel gratitude for what is right in front of us. Where would we be without Zoom and Google Meet? I am thankful for our technology, but we are inundated with so much information and creators posting millions of images and videos, all vying for our attention, a lot of times designed to be clickbait. What we see on social media can oftentimes be detrimental to our psyches and self-esteem, and the addiction to creating and keeping up with everyone else is an exhaustive beast. While technology has connected us in a time of enormous disconnect, it has also harmed the mental health of so many, especially those in the Generation Z age group. There is pressure to act and look a certain way, capture moments of the minute details, private moments of our days, and buy certain products, clothes, and other items that will make you even more attractive because it seems you're not attractive enough. You are neither thin nor pretty, handsome or cute enough. You need to have a filter on when you post. We live in a more amped up world of comparing ourselves constantly, negating ourselves, obsessing over total strangers we see online, and aspiring to the images they portray, which is most likely an illusion. The messages on social media have polluted us. Buy this, buy that, and you can look as amazing and be as popular as me. Let's face it, people are exhausted mentally, physically, and emotionally. We are looking to feel better in a time of immense turmoil and polarization. Many of us are numb to the horrific news about school shootings, suicide rates, depression, and hopelessness. Life is no longer about getting good grades and getting into a great school. Life means more to so many people, and it should. If we don't prioritize mental health in K-12 and in every aspect of society, where will students be in college and through adulthood? There has never been such chaos as there is now. People need to feel heard and shift what really matters in their lives. If you are fortunate enough to have spent time visiting a place you seldom visited, your true thoughts and feelings, welcome to an enlightened time. During the past few years, you experienced an incredible and surprising journey of self-discovery, a time of personal insight into what and who matters in your life, and what and who doesn't. And you have learned who lifts you up, listens to you, and who doesn't. Through all the tumult of the pandemic, the stories shared in this book illuminate everything from pandemic and online burnout to the root causes of depression and hopelessness. There are also bright spots in learning new things, reconnecting with oneself and others, and taking better care of our mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual health. Moving out of our comfort zone and trying new activities were also a theme in the pandemic. These are skills that can be transformative throughout your lifetime. If there is anything you can learn from this pandemic, it is that peeling back your layers is essential to discovering who you really are, seeing your current and past struggles, facing your mental health and wellness challenges, learning about your interests and aspirations, and overcoming obstacles that prevent you from taking the very best care of yourself. Tune into yourself, your family, friends, colleagues, teachers, complete strangers, and anyone in your life, because going back to normal and the way things used to be is no longer an option. Amping up your level of thoughtfulness, empathy, and compassion will enable you to tune in to what really matters, the life you truly want to live, and who you want along for the ride. Chapter 1, The Mental Health Crisis, The Silent Battle. I was trying to express I was struggling. I was trying to express that I could tell there was something wrong, and I would often just get blamed for it. I wasn't good with time management. I wasn't good with impulse control. I wasn't good. I later found out I have ADHD. I grew up not getting the support I needed as a neurodivergent person who has very extreme anxiety and self-soothing techniques that I created for myself. Rocket Garcia, 24. People have been suffering with mental health issues for centuries. Some people struggle their entire lifetime, and all it takes is something unexpected, like a pandemic or other life-changing event, to stir up just how much they have silently and painfully suppressed. However, it is never too late to address a mental health issue, especially if it has held you back from thriving, and you have felt the subject is just too taboo to talk about. The only problem is, there needs to be a mental health care system that is available to everyone, openly accepting, and with well-trained and educated staff and resources in place to meet the demand. Imagine that. Cultural acceptance and attitudes around mental health have influenced opinions and policymakers. If you suffer in silence, you might not have the knowledge, support, resources, or resilience to pull yourself out of a spiraling life filled with depression, hopelessness, addiction, anxiety, and more. Some of us hide our problems better than others, but when unforeseen circumstances occur, you just never know what someone will reveal. Oftentimes, this can be a post-pandemic incident that was tucked away like a Pandora's box. What is mental health? According to the World Health Organization, WHO, mental health is a state of mental well-being that enables people to cope with the stresses of life, realize their abilities, learn well, and work well, and contribute to their community. It is an integral component of health and well-being that underpins our individual and collective abilities to make decisions, build relationships, and shape the world we live in. Mental health is a basic human right, and it is crucial to personal, community, and socioeconomic development. Mental health is different for everyone, and factors such as biology, environment, and how we process the daily stressors and challenges of life affect us differently. Mental health encompasses your psychological, social, and emotional well-being and affects your thoughts, feelings, and actions. How you handle stress, your reactions to life events, and your relationships are all influenced by mental health. When the world was ravaged by COVID-19, any pre-existing problem you had might have been exacerbated, and more issues followed suit. The pandemic created a multitude of personal and professional struggles, and millions of people of all ages, ethnicities, gender identities, and socioeconomic backgrounds experienced loss, trauma, and uncertainty. These traumatic life experiences led to an increased need for mental health services that were not readily available to everyone, especially marginalized communities. As the demand for mental health professionals increased, a shortage of qualified counselors and therapists made life more challenging. In writing this book, I turned to my daughter, who struggled significantly before and at the beginning of the pandemic. She is now a 20-year-old college student majoring in psychology. I asked her why she thought we were in a mental health crisis before the COVID-19 pandemic began. Her responses made me pause and consider the fact that many adults do not know what it is like to be Generation Z in a pandemic or to be someone who is struggling with a mental illness. She made several important points about the mental health crisis prior to 2020. There were misconceptions and a lack of training and education on what mental health struggles look like. People didn't know how to diagnose mental health struggles. For example, school staff, therapists, counselors. There was no proper treatment. The people who struggled were afraid to speak up because of stigma and shame. People who struggle might not have supportive parents, and they might not feel understood. People who struggle might not have the support they need at all. I then asked my daughter to fill in the blanks on the following statement. People who struggle with mental health issues feel blank and blank. Her response was, people who struggle with mental health issues feel alone and misunderstood. She said other possible answers could be hopeless, anxious, depressed, unseen, or lonely. As a parent, I just sat with her responses for a bit and let them sink in, asking myself what it must feel like to live with these feelings before and during the pandemic. My heart was heavy, not just for her, but for anyone really. Biology, environmental factors, life circumstances, and the choices you make can also affect your mental health. This includes genetics, family history, traumatic childhood experiences, CACEs, or adverse childhood experiences assessment, and even problematic societal issues such as violence, inequities, discrimination, and poverty play a significant role. Prior to the pandemic, mental health struggles might have been exacerbated by some of the following: pre-existing mental health conditions, lack of attention to mental health struggles, racial disparities with regards to who can receive mental health care, unhealthy home life, lack of food, abuse, unhealthy relationships, etc., lack of sleep, tech addiction, decreased physical activity, substance abuse, stress, anxiety, and depression, post-traumatic experiences, discrimination, eating disorders, decreased sun exposure, lower levels of vitamin D, not feeling supported mentally and emotionally in school, work, or home, lower levels of self-esteem, motivation, and any interest in engaging socially, higher levels of social media exposure and engagement, feeling alone, depressed, and isolated in one's own struggles, not knowing who to turn to, loss of a loved one, parent, significant other, friend, relatives, others, increase in FOMO, fear of missing out feelings, lack of knowledge and skills for self-care, genetic mental health struggles, negative thoughts and behaviors, news events, feelings of shame, suffering in silence, lack of motivation for taking care of mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual health, lack of knowledge and skills for building resiliency, pressure in someone's personal, educational, or work life, physical, mental, and emotional abuse. Mental Health America, MHA, is a national organization dedicated to promoting mental health, prevention services, interventions, early detection of those at risk, and providing care and services. According to data from the MHA 2022 Mental Health in America report, in 2019, 50 million American adults had a mental illness. Suicidal ideation continues to increase every year since 2011, more so in the COVID-19 pandemic. The percentages of youth experiencing depression continue to increase. More than 2.5 million youth have major depression, and multiracial youth have a greater risk for depression. More than 27 million adults in the U.S. do not receive treatment for mental illness. More than 60% of youth who suffer from severe depression are not receiving treatment. Some adults and youth with a mental health illness do not have health insurance or insurance that covers mental health services. In fact, 950,000 youth had private health insurance that did not include mental health coverage. Substance abuse is increasing for adults and youth. On December 7, 2021, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services shared the following: U.S. Surgeon General issues advisory on youth mental health crisis, further exposed by COVID-19 pandemic. Surgeon General Vivek Murthy announced the urgency of mental health and wellness initiatives. Mental health challenges in children, adolescents, and young adults are real and widespread. Even before the pandemic, an alarming number of young people struggled with feelings of helplessness, depression, and thoughts of suicide, and rates have increased over the past decade. The COVID-19 pandemic further altered their experiences at home, school, and in the community, and the effect on their mental health has been devastating. The future well-being of our country depends on how we support and invest in the next generation. My response in reading this was relief in that mental health is finally becoming a priority, and there is now more awareness about mental health. But you might be wondering, okay, but what can be done about this crisis, and how soon? I know I am. Higher levels of anxiety, depression, feelings of hopelessness, isolation, loneliness, uncertainty, suicidal ideation, racial and ethnic health disparities, increased drug and alcohol use, and other crises reflect the chaos created by COVID-19. Healthcare professionals, school counselors, teachers, and other health and wellness professionals were pushed beyond their abilities, and many left the workforce. In a July 2022 article, "The Silver Lining of the Current Mental Health Crisis," Yahoo News shared that the number of people living with a mental illness has dramatically increased, but now people are seeking care to deal with their struggles. Here are some key takeaways. More personal and professional struggles resulted in greater demand for mental health services. In 2019, 1 in 5 American adults were living with a mental illness, and now the number of people suffering with depression has more than tripled. 8.5% pre-pandemic to 32.8% in 2021. The World Health Organization reported that anxiety and depression have increased 25% internationally. People are seeking more support than before the pandemic started. The next chapter will explore how we ended up in a mental health pandemic, specifically the factors that contributed to the increase in a need for mental health care and services, how the world was unprepared for a global pandemic on so many levels, a look at the behaviors that reflect the trauma and chaos inflicted by COVID-19, and how this deadly virus only exacerbated pre-existing mental health challenges. Buckle up. The year 2020 was a really bumpy ride. Chapter 2: The Making of a Mental Health Pandemic. I thought it was going to be like a really cool break from school for a few weeks, and it turned into 2 months and then 2 years. And it's been really annoying, and I hated wearing a mask everywhere. Jaden, 14. Mental health affects every aspect of our lives. Our ability to cope day to day while living in a pandemic is no small feat. Individual and societal problems and stress levels have never been this high, especially for marginalized communities already struggling mentally, emotionally, socially, and financially. Here's a look at how the mental health pandemic came to be. The origins of the mental health pandemic. It all began with pre-existing mental, emotional, physical, behavioral conditions that were kept hidden or not addressed, plus a mental health care system that was broken, already needing an overhaul, not providing equal access, not meeting the needs of people struggling, plus lack of resources, emotional and socioeconomical support, lack of knowledge and skills to address mental health struggles, and social and emotional needs, plus stigma, gender, and racial inequities, discrimination of all kinds, ageism, systemic racism, sexism, biases, plus the disruptor, COVID-19, resulting in a global pandemic causing a myriad of societal, socioeconomic, mental, physical, and emotional issues. Negative ripple effects of the pandemic. For example, millions of people out of work, lockdowns, social distancing, isolation, depression, anxiety, suicidal ideation, loss, feelings of hopelessness, substance abuse, mental health problems, and professionals not available to everyone, addiction, physical and emotional abuse at home, not doing well in school or work, etc. Plus, increase in personal and professional struggles, especially those who are teachers, healthcare workers, school counselors, students, people with pre-existing struggles of all kinds, etc. Plus, horrific behaviors and news events. For example, gun violence, school shootings, millions die around the globe from COVID-19, long-term effects of COVID-19, police brutality, racial and ethnic discrimination and violence, soaring rates of depression, anxiety, despair, suicide, physical and emotional abuse, substance abuse, etc. Plus, further stress and strain on hospitals, healthcare workers, and health and wellness professionals, teachers, and the mental health care infrastructure that was already in need of an overhaul within schools, businesses, other organizations, etc. Plus, alcohol and substance abuse before and/or during COVID-19. Plus, lack of preparation to handle the mental, emotional, and physical trauma created by the pandemic. Plus, societal fear, anger, polarization on numerous issues. Equals, mental health pandemic. It's August 8, 2022. And the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center, CRC, is reporting the following updates on COVID-19 cases and deaths. Total confirmed cases globally, 584,450,524. Total global deaths, 6,417,782. U.S. confirmed cases, 92,112,922. U.S. deaths, 1,033,556. These numbers alone are enough to keep us up at night, reclusive with our phones, Netflix, and Postmates. By the time I finish writing this book, these numbers will be even higher. The COVID-19 timeline. The following COVID-19 timeline is based on information from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the David J. Censor CDC Museum, as well as a January 9, 2021 article in Newsweek.com entitled, A Timeline of COVID-19 from Discovery to Vaccine, by Stephanie Parker, Diana Shishkina, and Betsy Ladyzetz. Key moments, December 12, 2019. Patients in Wuhan, Hubei Province, China, have symptoms of a mysterious upper respiratory illness. December 30, 2019. Li Wenliang, a Chinese ophthalmologist who worked at Wuhan Central Hospital in Wuhan, China, notifies his colleagues of a new respiratory virus spreading in Wuhan. December 31, 2019. The World Health Organization China Country Office is notified of numerous cases of pneumonia originating from Hunan Seafood Wholesale Market in Wuhan. January 2020. Li Wenliang contracts the virus from a patient. First coronavirus death reported in Wuhan is a 61-year-old man who frequently shopped at the Hunan Seafood Wholesale Market. Cases of the virus spread to Thailand, Japan, and South Korea. An American who traveled to Wuhan from Washington State contracts the virus. January 30, 2020. Thousands of people are infected and hundreds die. The World Health Organization announces a public health emergency, and travel to and from China is halted by President Donald Trump. February 7, 2020. Li Wenliang dies from the virus. February 11, 2020. The virus is named COVID-19. The World Health Organization names the disease spread by the novel coronavirus COVID-19. February 2020. I exit a local library in Orange County, California, and I see a small shrine dedicated to the late Li Wenliang. I begin to see more and more stories of COVID-19 in the news. March 2020. Over 100,000 cases worldwide. The WHO declares COVID-19 as a global pandemic. Mid-March, the U.S. begins to shut down schools, businesses, bars, and restaurants to prevent the spread of COVID-19. Over 3.3 million people file for unemployment. The Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act, CARES Act, is a $2.2 trillion economic stimulus bill passed by the 116th U.S. Congress, signed into law by President Donald Trump. U.S. residents who are eligible begin receiving $1,200 stimulus payments and an increase in unemployment benefits. April 2020. Over 1 million COVID-19 cases. Protests over the stay-at-home orders. July 2020. The U.S. has over 4 million cases and over 145,000 deaths. August 26, 2020. The Abbott Diagnostics antigen test is approved. November 4, 2020. The U.S. has over 100,000 cases in a day. December 2, 2020. U.S. hospitals caring for record number of COVID-19 patients, over 100,000. December 2020. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration gives emergency authorization to Moderna and Pfizer vaccinations. Our outdated, dysfunctional mental health care system. I want to set the stage for how we got to where we are in our current mental health pandemic. I am by no means a mental health professional, and I don't pretend to be one. I do, however, speak to people of all ages about their personal struggles, mental health challenges, support systems, or lack thereof, and personal journeys into trying to make sense out of the chaos we were living in. Some conversations in this book were supposed to last 30 minutes. Sometimes we spoke for 2 hours. Those 2 hours were often the highlight of my day. I felt honored and connected to a new human I had just met. We both needed space to share, vent, and connect in a time of disconnect. And sometimes it was also nice to have reassurance that the work I am doing really matters and makes a difference. To explain the state of our current mental health pandemic and how we got here, I am going to use the analogy of a house. Think of our U.S. mental health care system as a house that has been around a long time. Let's say the house is a home built in the 1800s, with old rickety floors and wood beams. It's a mess. The house hasn't been inspected and updated at all. There's probably decay, mold, termites, lead paint, asbestos, and a whole bunch of other unsafe issues. It's just an old house that no one tended to. People have come in from time to time and thrown a few coats of paint on, new curtains, rugs, and new furniture, but at its core, it's still an old, neglected house. The house really needs an update. All the other homes in the neighborhood now have high-speed internet and smart technology, but this house still has rotary phones. Some of you won't know what those are. LOL. And not enough people to take care of the house. One day, the owners started paying more attention to the house, and they had people come in to tackle a huge list of upgrades and repairs. Without updating the infrastructure of the house, they thought they would just make some cosmetic repairs and promote it as an Airbnb. The problem was, the house had never been upgraded, and there was so much to do. People didn't communicate well and think about the priorities and what people staying at the house would need and want. The owners hired clueless people to make upgrades, and the repair people were overwhelmed because there was a tight time frame to do everything. No one was on the same page, and it wasn't clear what the long-term plan for the house would be. There were not enough time and resources to do everything, and the real problems with the house were not even addressed. For example, slab leaks, rotting floors. The house was then promoted in a glitzy brand marketing campaign, and someone rented it out. Little did the renters know, they would not be getting what they paid for. The cost of upgrades and repairs was expensive, and the people who owned the house couldn't afford to do it all. To top it off, the people working on the house weren't compensated enough, often mistreated, disrespected, and couldn't handle all the problems that resulted from neglect and apathy. They quit out of frustration and mistreatment. Many left to do something else, and not even in the field they were skilled in. A massive storm was brewing, and the news outlets warned everyone that this one was going to be a doozy of a storm. When the heavy rain and high-speed winds hit the house, the roof split in two, and the neglected home was no match for the chaos and strength of the storm. The owners were out of touch, literally and figuratively, on vacation. They didn't consider that the storm would devastate the home and the people living in it. When they did return, they sought the original repair crew to fix things, but they were nowhere to be found. The house was in disrepair, and no one had a clue how to make the repairs and upgrades. I think you get the idea. The house represents the mental health care system that has long been neglected. No one prioritized its care and updating. Now, we live in a time when the pandemic storm has ripped the roof off of our lives and revealed a healthcare system that needed an overhaul yesterday. Policymakers, educators, businesses, and other stakeholders must agree on the basic structure and rebuild so we can provide the proper training and education and get the skilled and talented and resources needed to address the needs of those struggling socially, emotionally, and mentally. We must also value those who work in education, healthcare, and other essential positions who sacrifice their own safety and well-being because they are passionate and driven to make a difference. Positive psychologist Sonia Lubomirsky, author of The How of Happiness, published in 2007, developed the Subjective Happiness Scale, which measures our subjective happiness. Lubomirsky shares that happiness is affected by three things: life circumstances, genetics, and the choices we make. With Lubomirsky's research in mind, I considered how happiness was affected during the pandemic. Our happiness levels plummeted, and not surprisingly. Happiness and our ability to stay positive and optimistic has been affected by 1. Life circumstances not in our control. We had no control over this life-changing disruptor, COVID-19, resulting in lockdowns, working from home, job loss, social isolation, and so many other scenarios. 2. Genetics. If we were predisposed to depression, anxiety, substance abuse, manic depression, bipolar disorder, and other mental health issues, we went deeper into a rabbit hole, or maybe experienced a darker side to ourselves because of trauma, either recent or in childhood. 3. Our choices. When faced with COVID-19 and everything that happened because of the virus, we might have experienced negative thoughts and behaviors, which could be detrimental to our minds, bodies, emotions, and relationships. Drugs, alcohol, vaping, tech addiction, antisocial behavior, and other negative behaviors help people numb out. These negative choices dramatically affect us mentally, physically, and emotionally. June 17, 2022. The World Health Organization published an urgent report to overhaul our mental health care system and mental health initiatives. Report urges mental health decision makers and advocates to step up commitment and action to change attitudes, actions, and approaches to mental health, its determinants, and mental health care. The 2022 scientific report by the WHO found that the COVID-19 pandemic caused a 25% global increase in anxiety.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.